is Jason Jackson. I'm a faculty member of the Department of Folklore and Ethnomusicology. I begin today's auspicious gathering filling in for our colleague Ray Cashman. Ray is the director of the Folklore Institute. In partnership with our department chair David McDonald and the department's dedicated staff, Ray has worked over many months to gather us all here today. He's sorry he can't be with us on this auspicious occasion, but he's happily carrying our good work forward in Galway, Ireland, where he's co-leading a study abroad course with some of our students. Now, some here have attended all 12 past Richard M. Dorson lectures. While this is the first time for some of you, it's important to both remember the lecturer's namesake and to thank those who made this series possible. Richard Dorson, whom we recall here, played a key role in building up and institutionalizing the field of folklore studies on our campus and in the larger world. Sharing Richard Dorson's commitment to strengthening folkloristics, a group of friends of our department generously endowed this annual lecture so that we can welcome leading scholars to our campus, not only for this annual lecture, but for informal exchange with our students and with our whole campus community. I invite you to visit the department's website to learn more about the lecture and those outstanding colleagues who have joined us previously. Before introducing the next Dorson lecture, I want to acknowledge the Dorson family. At various times, we've welcomed members of the family to this gathering. We're always thrilled when they can join us. This year, we've received regrets, but also forceful well wishes from the Dorson family, with Jeff Dorson wishing us great success and Roland Dorson sending his best wishes. Thanks to them for their continued interest in our work. I want to also express appreciation to all who have worked within the Department of Folklore and Ethnomusicology to bring this year's distinguished lecturer to campus. In my thanks, I also want to include our generous and thoughtful colleagues working in Estonian studies and in the Department of Central Eurasian Studies more broadly, who organize companion events with our guests. In those contexts, it's now a tremendous pleasure to introduce the 2004 Richard M. Dorson lecturer, Professor Ülo Valk. Ülo is a true leader within international folkloristics. In saying that, I'm equally mindful of his intellectual leadership and his dedicated stewardship institutions, organizations, research networks, and scholarly projects, all of which have advanced our field. Ülo is professor of Estonian and Comparative Folklore at the Institute for Cultural Research at the University of Tartu, where he has previously served as head of the institute and where he has led the Department of Estonian and Comparative Folklore since 1995. During this time, he's also been a visiting professor Beijing Normal University, the University of Pennsylvania, the University of California, and the University of Kiel. He has undertaken many research projects, often with the benefit of large competitive grants, and he maintains a scholarly focus in two diverging world areas. He's an authority on Estonia and its complicated European, regional, and historical contexts, and he's also an active scholar concerned with the peoples and traditions of India. What unites Ülo's work in these two areas is a focus concerned with religious phenomena and associated issues of belief and verbal narrative genres. The impressive and orderly, very Estonian research information system tracks 288 of Ülo's publications and 16 of his major team-based grant-funded projects. Because I'm eager for you to hear from Ülo, I'll just note that he's published in all of the major journals and folklore studies. Among his key works available in English are The Black Gentleman, Manifestations of the Devil in Estonian Folk Religion, and two edited volumes co-edited with Marion Bowman, Vernacular Knowledge from 2022 and Vernacular Religion in Everyday Life from 2012. His list of accomplishments is unbounded, but I note here he's also trained many leading folklorists. Since 1996, he has chaired or co-chaired 48 PhD dissertation and master's thesis committees, and he's presently working with at least 7 more doctoral students. And those students and former students are doing remarkable work under his guidance. One would be hard-pressed to meet all of the folklorists now working in Tartu, Estonia, in the course of a month or maybe perhaps even in a year. Tartu is an extraordinary hub for our field and for the partner discipline of ethnology. Its excellence has a history and a context. The Estonian people are passionate about their own cultural heritage and enduringly curious about their Nordic, Baltic, and Finno-Ugric speaking neighbors. Generations of folklorists there have built up extraordinary archival and ethnographic collections. And Tartu faculty and students have a long history of producing outstanding research. The university as a whole is innovative. has also been played by our guest. Just this week, Ulo has been busy writing the new grants that, when funded, will keep folklore studies in Tartu private. The best way for you to learn more about Ulo and his work is for me to now get out of the way and to ask you to join me in welcoming the 2024 Richard Anderson Lecturer, Professor Ulo.
Well, this is folklore, we don't know what exactly happened. keep away from our territory, so we know that this doesn't happen. In the year 1939, when Stalin made an agreement, and East Europe was divided, Estonia, Latvia and Lithuania went under Soviet control. Well, the table is a remarkable object, and the story is connected both with this lady lilac and with the table. That's what Piret told. And now, actually, to tell the truth, I had to go back to record the story once again, because of course I didn't have a recorder when Piret started to tell the recent news from the Literary Museum. But that's the story that she told me the second time, a couple of days later. On Monday, when I came to work, I saw that something serious had happened. The upper jammed and the door had fallen down. Jammed is the word that I really had to check in the dictionary, this upper part of the construction of the door. And it is massive, and it had hit the parquet with its nails 5 centimeters long. One can imagine what could have happened if this would have fallen during the working day and somebody would have been standing there. It gets interesting because I started to joke. The lady in lilac is active again. It was easy to find the reason. On Friday, I had shown the room to an excursion group from Ukraine. Well, the story is here, and the outcome of this accident is being cleaned up. Colleagues from Ukraine are visiting us, and we showed the table at the Tartu Peace Street to them. I told them that earlier we used to talk about the lady in lilac in this room, because she comes out of the fireplace at 11 p.m. By then I leave the house, but now we don't need to talk about the lady in lilac because we have this grand table. It gets all the attention and we can talk about a very important event in the history of Estonia, the peace treaty of Tartu. As the jam had fallen down, I made the connection that this was a punishment to me for saying that we won't talk about the lady in lilac anymore. This room, she was insulted. Folklorist Eda Kalmbrem has studied the stories about the lady in lilac. She came here and saw what had happened. She made some photos and told me, "Piret, you should put one perfume into the fireplace and you will be friends again." Now it's peacefully silent again. The perfume is in the fireplace. Shared. And as you look at this photo, and now this, the two photos, our dear president, Mr. Karis, and the group of folklorists, and our first lady are sitting just in front of this fireplace. Can you imagine how entangled it becomes? There is history. Next to this is the table where the peace treaty was signed. There are folklorists, and this fireplace where the lady in lilac appears every night. It all comes together, so it is not so easy to clarify, to make sense what is going on in such situations. You need to take a focus. But let's the situation now. Well, we all folklorists, we have to safeguard the tradition maintain them, and one of the ways is, of course, taking care of the Folklore archive are in the same building. And there are tens of thousands of traditional stories about encounters with the supernatural entities, like the lady in lilac. And this work started in the 19th century, at the time of modernization. Well, that's a reference to quite a useful book by Jason Joseph von Storm, The Myth of Disenchantment, that we have used as a reader in our PhD seminars. And what I have to say here about modernity is that it has been characterized as the age of secularization and disenchantment and Sauber, as Max Weber famously called it. Taylor, who, when I'm quoting him, that dimension of science is a watertight distinction between two realms, the natural versus the supernatural, was made. And scientists did not need the transcendental, but explained the natural on its own terms, the supernatural started to lose its relevance. As we know, 19th century European folklorists were active participants in grand social projects. On one hand, or with one hand, they were building the nation, and with the other hand, they were building modernity. Documentation and stories about the supernatural turned personal memories into textual artifacts, pieces of evidence from the past, well, literary monuments of some ancient obsolete old belief. So the modernization did not affect the humans only, it also engaged the spirit world. The spirit world was romanticized, its inhabitants were turned into fictional characters, and folklorists as representatives of a new scientific discipline added one more discursive layer here to an intertextual web to this supernatural other world. Well, the discursive way of folkloristics, together with the classification into legend and tale types, also they provided housing to the spirits in archival boxes and in the compartments of genres and text anthologies. The massive project of turning legend into a literary genre concealed its experiential side to such an extent that it seemed a major discovery when Lauri Hongo, in his grand monograph, Beistenlaube in Ingermanland, they believed in spirits in the land of Ingria, well, he showed that stories about spirits are rooted in experiences. Spirits are empirical creatures. They are not just entities in legends or folk tales. They are something, somebody that you might now and then witness, see, encounter. And later, the work of David Harper confirmed that without doubt, some encounters with the supernatural are real on a psychological level. And here is also the title page of a very well-known great monograph by late Gillian Bennett, The Last Four Ghosts, about the storytelling about ladies, mainly women in England, the communication. Here is also one table from the book by Josephson Storm, and I'm not going to comment it much, but it shows the percentage of people in the United States and in Great Britain, well, who share beliefs and experiences about haunted houses, astrology, extraterrestrials, communication with the dead, necromancy, and about witches and witchcraft. They're quite remarkable numbers, well, including the board here. And as regards Estonia, which is a very secular country, there was a poll in the year 2020 conducted by the Estonian Council of Churches. It was titled On Life, Faith and Religious Life. It appeared that 32.5% of the people in Estonia have had supernatural or other inexplicable experiences in their lives. So many people in Estonia report about encountering ghosts, apparitions, guardian angels, benevolent dead aliens, UFOs, and other unidentified entities. I'm teaching an introductory course at the University of Tartu, Introduction to Folkloristics, and one of the assignments that the students get is to contribute something. It is to the student folklore archives every year. There is a certain theme is announced together with a questionnaire. This year the topic was encounters with wild animals, but always the students have had an alternative, an option to choose between different questionnaires, and one of those have been my own personal encounter with the supernatural, my own unusual experiences, how it happened, what kind of framework of interpretation has been offered, it is in what situations I tell the story, etc., such questions. And there were 60 students this year who finished the course, and it was 17 out of the 60 who decided to share their own experiences with me. So we collected more than 20 experience stories. But the first example that I bring, it comes from my field work. It is from a real estate agent in Tartu. It was recorded in November last year. And here, this building of red bricks is the place, the haunted house that the lady is talking about. There was one case when the tenants refused to pay the rent. So that Veski Street 7-9, these buildings are more than 100 years old, large apartments with very high ceilings. The owner was a doctor, and the family had been doctors for three generations. They were renting out the apartment. Tenants lived there for 1 month and said that they won't pay. The apartment is haunted. Well, I asked, how come? What happened? And the answer was, I don't know. These people were my friends and they didn't know what to think. They had owned the place for three generations, all were doctors, and there were no ghosts whatsoever. And now a tenant moved in and the big place became haunted. Probably he had brought the ghost along somewhere. What seems remarkable here is this cognitive dissonance. One might expect that the family of doctors who has not experienced haunting would deny the phenomenon and wonder what is wrong with the tenant. Instead, they do not doubt in the fact of haunting, but they ask the question, a very scientific question, is why? What has caused the haunting? Yet, as I have not interviewed the owners of the house, I stop the speculation here and I come to the next story told by the same real estate agent. Now you can see the building as it was in the year 2019 when it was demolished, and the new building that has been constructed on the same place. And so that's the case about the Mag Street number 5. The house was built in the 1950s and it was empty. Was in a bad shape and they met the interested people inside the house. The sun was shining, it was slightly freezing in the month of March. We were standing on the stairs and suddenly the door was shut behind me with a terrible bang. Later, one physicist asked me if I knew the story of this house. I didn't know because the owner had not told this to me. He told me, but the professor of physics at the University of Tartu, a very well known scholar, but I don't tell his name here, of course. He told me the story and I was surprised. Indeed, this could have been the ghost Omitus who expressed the opinion. The physicist had lived in the next street during his childhood, Pumba Street. He said that there was an old lady living in the house and this happened in winter. The washing rooms, the sauna was located in the backyard. She came from sauna, fell and died there because of hypothermia. So what was this bang that I heard? No wind, all doors and windows were closed. It was a beautiful sunny day in March. And then the door rang, the windows were shaking. There was no wind, no draught. But in this example, an explicit connection is made between the ghosts and afterlife beings. The tragic death case introduced here as the cause of haunting. Interpretation that was offered by the professor of physics at the University of Tartu. It's quite remarkable, again, that well, he's not offering a scientific explanation, something about air movement in the building, or it's caused by some changes of temperature, or maybe a naughty neighbor making a crank there. He gives a supernatural interpretation of the event. So here it is time to say something about the vernacular, first as a concept and about the related methodology. Leonard Primiano introduced it as a folkloristic approach to the study of religion with focus on individual experience and its personal interpretation. Well, he developed this approach already in the mid-1980s, quite early. It was before in the study of religion, some of the approach that we know on the lived religion studies, it came into being. So it was indeed a very novel approach from Leonard. And that's the most famous quote of the vernacular religion is religion as it is lived, as human beings encounter, understand, interpret, and practice it. And he says it's not the synonym of folk religion, it's not the dichotomous or the dialectical partner of institutional religious forms. Another article of his on vernacular religion and his comments on the concept were published in this book. The first print was indeed in 2012. Well, here he says that the concept shifts the way one studies religion, with the people becoming the focus of study and not religion or belief as abstractions. And the objects of study is verbal, behavioral, and material expressions of belief. And what I have to add here is that vernacular is quite instrumental as a hybrid concept. We use many dividing notions, such as hybrid versus low, folkloric versus altered, belief versus knowledge, natural versus supernatural, but communication often reveals ambiguity. Seems set apart in ideal typological abstract thinking appears as entangled and uncertain in everyday interaction. Vernacular expressions undermine analytic dichotomies and reveal their dialectic cohesion. So when I come back to the comment given by the professor of physics, well, humans are not monolingual, but we master different discourses and modes of thought, such as rational, poetic, magical, mystical, well, different kinds of ways of processing the world. And communication events, public or private, serious or trivial, dark or light, they trigger different expressive modalities. An active scientist, of course, can be equally creative in developing vernacular theories of afterlife and the interaction, about interaction between the living and the dead. We're talking about the vernacular hybrid concepts. One of them is now the word supernatural. As an analytic category, it has been critically examined and problematized, mainly due to its theological and philosophical connotations. It's mainly the criticism comes from the scholars of anthropology and study of religion. And they have recommended even to jettison the concept. So often you find it's replaced by some synonyms or common words such as anomalous, paranormal, luminous, etc. However, I prefer the supernatural for two main reasons. On the one hand, the concept has become part of the vernacular discourses, vernacular theorizing. And that's an approach and a focus that was introduced into folkloristics by some bright American scholars, as well as Charles Briggs, and referring to his work here. So, supernatural is easily understandable for everybody, and it's also semantically open. The word can refer to anomalous phenomena, extraordinary experiences, but also to their representations, both in religious and fictional forms, folklore, literature, film, the arts, etc. So the semantic indefiniteness of the supernatural, well, both as a phenomenon and a trope, distinguishes it from other concepts such as the paranormal, improve semantics. Well, it's good to think. From a folkloristic point of view, its modalities are connected to several genres. Let's say it's a transgeneric concept. And it's a quality, a trait of some genres, including narrative genres. It can evoke perceptions related to these genres. So we can talk about the affordance of a genre, a set of genres, what they do with our thinking and with the perception of the world. Legends are not narratives only, they also represent a mode of thinking and make us perceive the world in a certain way. But that's a very Bakhtinian approach. Genres are not just tools of classification, they're modes of thought, they're world views. Now I come to the next example, and this comes, these are some passages from an interview with a woman who works in this hospital in Malawi. Her age is around, well, I didn't ask, it's around 30, 35 maybe. She's an ethnic Estonian, but she has studied medicine at the University of Edinburgh. Well, it's a very haunted town, but that's not where she brought the knowledge of the ghosts. It's more about vernacular theorizing and about experiences. And now she works in the medical lab at this hospital. So she was interested in talking to me, well, meeting me. And first she had to ask permission from her superiors. Well, she got the permission. And the interview happened in Tallinn on the 21st of January last year. I called her niece in this paper, not to disclose her real name. And she told me that while working on night shift, she started to have strange experiences now and then. Several times she had seen from the corner of eye somebody walking by the door and pushing a cart in the corridor. However, nobody was there. He said that she did not know about the stories about ghosts in the hospital. When she had told her colleagues about her experiences, she heard that the others also had similar moments at night. As the ghost seemed to be a medical worker, they discussed that he might be some former worker who is now wanting the hospital. So what Denise said, in the corridor leading to microbiology, there are fridges and glass doors. In the darkness, you can see reflections there, but not very clearly. What did I do? When I had to go there at night in the darkness, I made some strange moves. I made a little dance so that my brain would recognize that it is me in the reflection and not the ghost. Human brain is such an expert in recognizing and seeing all kinds of patterns, even if there are no patterns. After all, I'm a scientist, as regards my preparation and my job. And I ask, however, does it feel slightly scary in such situations? He said, indeed, it feels slightly scary. It was worse in the beginning when I was not used to this. By now, I'm used to night shifts and working at night. Now I feel this much less. However, it depends on recent experiences. Something scary has happened. We also have non-ghost scary things. For example, a strange person comes and asks you to open the door. Some kind of suspicious fellow. And the interview continued. Annelise expressed her ideas about these cases of haunting. And that's what she said. I have one more interesting idea. I have been thinking that we had a patient in intense care with acute sepsis. Many of his blood samples came to microbiology. I had thought that as much as his blood reached microbiology, he might be haunting there. However, until now, I have no evidence that this is him. The scientist looks for evidence, of course. True, I must say that after he died, no ghosts have been seen in microbiology. Maybe he protects us. So what we see here, things are left pretty open. We can talk about uncertain epistemological uncertainty. And people are ready, they are really eager to discuss matters. We also find emotional reactions, anxiety about these events. And we can really make a list of other words. That is the technological other world, technology that keeps haunting. Then there is this other world of the restless dead, maybe, and also social other world. Strange people come and scare people. These are definitely real people. So from here, let's go to the next example. And this comes from North Estonia, from the Spalmuse So the manor is located in Lahemaa National Park, and there is a museum, a hotel, and a restaurant that attracts many, many guests. And some years ago, Kostel worked as a cook, as a chef in this restaurant, and he lived in a hotel located in a historical building. And it was a common knowledge among the local people that these buildings are haunted. What Kostel said in the beginning of the interview is that actually I do not believe in ghosts. Always there is some kind of explanation of the things, but folklorists know that very often this introduces stories about ghost experience. It's kind of true. I do not believe this, we don't believe this or that, but that's what happens. There is evidence for this. And after he told me about his multiple uncanny experiences, well, the interview lasted 1 hour and 30 minutes. With the same statement, still I do not believe in ghosts. Instead, I believe that there is always some logical explanation for everything. Simply sometimes it's difficult to think about this logical explanation. The word explanation, explain or unexplainable, appeared in the interview for 16 times. So it's a big question how to explain these things happening. And before discussing his explanations, let's mention briefly what kind of experience Kasper had had. Well, before moving to Padlense, he said that he had witnessed something earlier. Sometimes he had experienced mysterious silence, that there was a background noise, strong noise, and then suddenly it stopped. It was complete silence. And it happened in certain places. It was strange, unusual. He emphasized that he was not afraid of his strange encounters, but he admitted that one of these moments of silence had indeed been a bit scary. Well, the interview focused on his life in this haunted Palouse manor. And one of his powerful experiences was the sleep paralysis that struck him one night. He was sleeping but woke up seeing a dark woman sitting on his chest in a straddled position. Kasper could not move. The situation lasted for about 30 seconds. This was the only time when he actually saw something. And there was another moment when he thought that he saw something, maybe. He was in front of the hotel and saw a woman standing behind the window of the empty hotel, looking at Kasper. Later he realized that this particular window had no curtains, and he concluded that this must have been the sun reflection. Many times he had heard unusual sounds and voices when he used to walk by the empty, unused kitchen. He heard noises and voices as if somebody was working there. Twice he tried to record it with his mobile phone, but without any success. He heard sounds from the distance, but when he looked into the kitchen, it was empty and all was silent. And once, when he was getting ready to take a bath in his bathroom, that's what he told about this event. I was alone. The hotel directory was closed. The hotel was locked. I went to my room late in the evening and started to run water in my bath. I heard that a girl, but not a very little girl, shouted, "Emma," not "Emma." Sadly, not very intensely, but it was clear and loud enough. This moment I was scared. Generally, when I was in the building, I was thrilled. It was not scary, but it was, well, thrilling. And I had no fear in my room, but that moment I thought, damn, maybe I'm afraid to take the bath. And he laughed. Yes, this moment was scary. Otherwise, all that seemed funny. What is going to happen now? And there was another moment when he heard somebody was walking after me when he was walking to the other building. The locks of the same doors were opened. There was some noise. Somebody was following me. There were parrots in a cage in one room. They started to make such a noise that they were trying to break the cage to get out. This was truly an infernal noise. Suddenly everything was silent. Sometimes the lights went off and on and off in empty rooms. As regards the explanation, Kasper thought that lights would go on because of motion sensors. However, it remained unclear why the motion sensors sometimes strange noises in the building could have been caused by changes, air conditions, and boilers. However, there was no good explanation why he could not record these sounds and why the noise stopped when he went to this room. So there was a discrepancy between the uncanny experience and the rather narrow interpretive framework that Kaspar applied. The explanation that he offered failed to make sense. They were neither convincing nor logical. However, the epistemological failure didn't bother Kaspar, who appeared at least as a brave man in his experience stories. And in this interview, there are many references to former storytelling situations, the ghostly experiences were shared by people working on the manor, and so the stories became a part of the discursive tradition. And we also see something in this storytelling in Kaspar's discussions that's one of the distinctive features of legend as a genre, as indicated by the Dorson, who has written about the rhetoric truth in the legendary, making different kinds of claim about the veracity or debunking the stories. But I decided to skip one example here, not to make the lecture too long, and I will, from here I go to a discussion. So these were only a few examples that I gave. I could bring many more. I have collected them during the last 3 years in Estonia. Sometimes quite randomly, sometimes systematically from people, and they didn't talk about legends that you find in tourist books, legends told by the tourist guides, legends that you find on social media, that you find in books, in films, etc. And what is common among these verbal accounts is that they all are quite disturbing reports about lived reality. But fortunately, we folklorists were alone in our attempts to make sense what is going on here. So I'm referring to steam for the notion of the bounded or porous mind. It was outlined by Charles Taylor in his famous monograph, The Secular Age. The basic distinction lies between experiencing the self, either as buffered, separated from the world, or open to outside entities, permeable to emotions, to thoughts, to seeing maybe something invisible, the idea that we are connected with the environment, between humans, between animals, that we are not separated from each other. Taylor linked the notion of the porous self with the enchanted world of spirits and magic, and the buffered self with the disenchanted world. Luhrmann's project confirmed Taylor's ideas by providing big amount of empirical data from China, Ghana, Thailand, Vanuatu, and the United States. Well, just to give a quote, what Daniel Luhrmann has written, the more a person imagines the mind-world boundary as porous, as permeable, the more they report vivid, near sensory experiences of invisible others. And here are titles of a couple of more books. By Charles Taylor, and then Daniel Luhrmann recently published a book, How World Becomes Real, where he developed her ideas, how does it happen that worlds and spirits become and remain real to people. She has studied the acts of real making, that's how she calls this communication in prayer, the ritual worship. Well, it's a kind of effort, hard work that people do in these small moments that she calls kindling the supernatural other. And she has shown how people make relations with invisible others. She has introduced concepts like parakosm, a private, but shared imagined world. Well, as an example, she brings thought as Middle Earth, so the parakosm can be both fictional and religious. And she writes, this word is sufficiently rich in detail that people become engaged in the stories and can return to them again and again. Luhrmann showed that parakosms can be created well in different genres. And she has taken inspiration from the work of another scholar, Professor Sarah Hyde Johnston, who works at Ohio State University. Well, in this book, The Story of Mark, she has studied the ways of Greeks, ancient Greeks, engaged in their mythology with the gods, and how the gods and supernatural world became an active participant in the life worlds of the Greeks. And both scholars, Johnston and Luhrmann, they write about parasocial relationships as people engage with fictional characters because they are so convincing that they prompt the same emotional and cognitive reactions in us as real people do, writes Professor Luhrmann, referring to Professor Johnston. And both authors write about the plurimediality as a story told again and again in a character who is presented in different ways. And these factors lead to interaction with the invisible other. As Luhrmann writes, the interaction with the invisible other is one of the central features that sets the special world of faith apart from fiction. She makes a clear distinction between faith and belief. And faith involves hard work, mental and bodily practices that leads to these intimate relationships with the invisible others. Well, we folklorists are more used to the concept of belief. And that is connected maybe with slightly different practices. But according to Luhrmann, the God becomes real because he's made real by conscious efforts, by people who are willing to experience God. Well, they also write, both authors, about episodic narrating, that the same characters appear in different genres and different narratives, and this makes the supernatural world really well close to us and quite colorful and detailed, and it makes it feel like real. Now there is one more scholar whose name I would like to mention. This is Dirk Johansen, professor of cultural history at the University of Oslo. And he has studied legend traditions as sensory practices, suited to augment reality with elements of a mythical story world. Legends, as he writes, are both descriptive and prescriptive. Legends can create reality. As well, he quotes Linda Deeg. Dirk Johansen analyzes these processes more closely as he writes about narrative culture as shared regimes of attention, about entanglement and narrative and sensory perception, about predictive processing. Legends in his discussion represent an immersive story world. And he shows, well, he has studied the 19th century Norwegian legends, and at this time there was a serious the enlightened clergyman fight against the superstitious simple people, and the clergyman considered the stories about supernatural encounters as dangerously immersive, as they could lure people into a magical reality. So people were telling stories about encountering spirits and the supernatural, and the clergyman, they realized that there's something wrong with the stories. If we eliminate these stories, age of enlightenment, then we can get rid of experiences as well. So something quite insightful. But now we come back to this memory that's bringing from 21st century Estonia, and we see a very different situation as regards how people think of themselves and their personalities. In Estonia, we certainly represent the buffet minds. We keep social distance. During the COVID time, there was a joke that when authorities introduced this rule that to keep 2 meters social distance, it was difficult for us to follow it because we were used to 3 meters. Making it only 2 meters was kind of, well, difficult to follow. So the spirit world is still there. It hasn't gone away. So maybe we can argue that modernity is haunted by the paracosma of the past, in enchanted world of ghosts and spirits from 19th century, from earlier times. That once this world was perhaps coherent and concrete, and it was built up by different genres and by media, but today it has fallen apart and we can witness only fragments. Therefore, people are uncertain how to identify the supernatural entities or talk about them in public, so they feel uncomfortable about the experience. But this would take us back to this grand narrative of secularization and cultural evolutionism, which doesn't help us further. In the examples that we heard individuals involved, they make no efforts of real making, of evoking the supernatural. The experiences they describe are rather they are disturbing. They convey also emotional reactions, perplexion, sometimes even fear. People who participate in the events involved sense them as out of the ordinary, not of this world. They are normal. And they are struggling to verbalize and the experiences that are uncomfortable, as they make no sense. But these stories are fragmentary and chaotic, and here I'm referring to the work from this university, who has written about untellability. The limited comfort or ability of the narrator because of perceived reactions of context, such as narrator interpretation of discursive safety or risk. In some cases, the experience behind the stories can even be considered traumatic or stigmatizing. When Diane Goldstein and Professor Amy Schumann have both about these concepts. And in a rational society dominated by scientific mindset, encountering a ghost can signal a psychiatric problem. Depending on the audience, storytelling can be a therapeutic act. There is a strong relation between experience and storytelling. It's necessary to verbalize what happened. It's a continuation of the event. So we can talk about finalizing experience in storytelling. What is important is the providing the interpretive frame, some kind of explanation, or making attempts of a different interpretations just to make sense. So sense making is more important than real making, very, very often, at least in these cases. People are looking for explanations, seem unavoidable, but they hardly succeed. So we folklorists are used to study marginalized and overlooked phenomena, considered unworthy and redundant by other disciplines. Experienced stories of the uncanny deserve attention as they point at the limits of the cracks of reason. As my Danish colleague Kirsten Maria Rohauge has called them, she has studied the ghost narratives, ghost experiences of Danes today, and Denmark is even more secular society than Estonia is today, yet the Danes, they have problems with the haunted homes and buildings. I have titled my lecture Immersed in the Story World, colon, full stop, but perhaps I should replace it with a question mark. The story world here does not appear as a parakos, but as a kind of underworld, disturbingly compelling in its reality. And finally, I would like to offer you one more example, that's the last one. And this was written by one of our students, that's now from this set of this last semester's collection. It was written by a student from Russian Federation who wrote in the Estonian language and translated the story into English. It was 21st of June, Tuesday, year was 2005. We drove through Dikhvin town, it's in northern Russia, in the morning, and we're planning to arrive in South Vepsa, the Rosh village. The road was very bad. We made stops on the way, sometimes driving 20 kilometers per hour, 12 miles per hour approximately. There were no cars on the road. Several times we thought that we were lost. It was night and we kept driving. There were no villages, no houses. There was thick forest around us. Suddenly we saw a woman standing on the road. She had stretched her arm. Stop, let's take her along. My friend started to stop the car. Was driving very slow. The woman kept her hand stretched out. She bowed towards the front window and looked at me. Her face was like a mask. Her eyes had no pupils. They were white. I screamed. speed in the car. What was this? It did not make sense. After an hour, we stopped between the houses of a small Vepsian village. The Vepsian culture is one of these more Finnic culture. Vepsian language belongs to the Finnic language family. We spent the night in the car, and in the morning we told about the encounter with the people in the village. Maybe this woman got lost in the forest. Nobody's lost here. We know everybody. So what was this? And now some statements that the woman made. First, it was not an illusion. It was mid-June, the nights are not dark. We both saw the same thing. Second, the woman was wearing grey clothes, a long shirt and close-fitting overcoat, a grey apron. This was the fashion of late 19th, early 20th century. Today, nobody would go to the forest in such a clothing. Fourth, it was mid-June. There are no berries, no mushrooms in the forest. People do not go to the forest during this season. And fifth, the woman bent toward the car as a stick of wood. Her hand was stretched, so there was something inhuman about this creature whom they encountered. I think we all recognize the legendary vanishing hitchhiker in the local cultural settings. What seems remarkable is that this Finnic student from Russian Federation did not know about this international migratory legend. I told her about this and she was quite stunned. So are these, after all, migratory legends about the vanishing hitchhiker? Are we talking about the legends migrating, or are we talking about ghosts migrating, like the hitchhiker on the road, on the moon? Well, the world is a mysterious place. Or maybe, after all, the story world is even more immersive than we can imagine. It maybe breaks the solid walls of our rational thinking and shapes our perception in the ways we cannot comprehend. And also, let's not exclude the possibility that this was a prank, something that we did not consider. Somebody was standing there on the road, maybe young people from the next village, just to scare the only drivers. Maybe they knew about the vanishing hitchhiker, but we just know. We don't know what this uncertainty that we are with here. And I tell the truth, I tend to be skeptical. And even if it was a prank, it illustrates how legend shaped live realities as they acted out. And the story ended in an epilogue. We got back to Vinica without other incidents. I told about the event to a couple of friends. People believe such things. But what happens is meant to be personal. It's quite remarkable. It's meant to be personal. So there is some kind of this individual, intimate, or vernacular dimension in this. It's coming back to the concept of vernacular. And therefore, other people remain indifferent. It's something that is for you. It's just personal for you. And once I discussed such stories with a journalist from Sevdekar, from Comparative, a friend of mine, he said, "That's nothing unusual. These are ordinary Finnic stories." So the last sentence brings us back to one of the basic folkloristic concepts, the notion of tradition. And there is some vernacular knowledge out there, how people make their uncanny experience meaningful. Meaning-making has roots in vernacular theorizing, and we as folklorists have work to do, not to give up, but carry on in building interpretive frameworks, even cases that contradict our own rational thinking. But that's the end of my talk. Thank you very much.
Something and you don't really know what it is until after the fact, and you sort of you taken apart based on traditional knowledge. So what happens when that traditional knowledge is broken off? Are you finding that most of these just get classed into that sort of catch-all of ghost? Or do people seem to know the stories that belong to something, even if they no longer know the name of the thing? I found it interesting that you went immediately to the Vanishing Hitchhiker, when I feel like there must be some local models that might fit better with this spooky woman that they encountered on the road.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, we also, back to the discussion about the ethnic genres and ethnic terminology. And in the realm of the supernatural, it's of course very advanced in traditional societies. There is a lot of discussion and a lot of ways how people identify certain creatures, what makes them distinct or different, and what are the ways, the knowledge is there, is how to deal with them. Which ones are dangerous, which ones are not so dangerous. And for Lopi Honko, well, for him also, the starting was the experience. Of course, he brought in quite heavy psychological theory about perceptions, about illusions. And he connected the memoirs with the traditional legendary that provides the framework. That's like the tradition, it's an authority that controls individuals, that provides the knowledge which is there, which is public. And this also kind of normalizes experiences. They become a part of shared tradition. There is nothing unusual about this. You can say there is nothing supernatural about this, because the supernatural is a part of culture. But in our society, it becomes out of the place, or out of the ordinary. And of course, the knowledge about the identification of different kind of entities or a different kind of legend motives, it's not the same as it used to be. New interpretive frames are coming, or at least in Estonia, it's very often to interpret things through some kind of energies that affect people, but people also read books published by folklorists. They study the books on mythology and try to make links between the experience and what is fictionalized world of spirits. But yes, and I agree with you that perhaps it was a bit pushy or to bring in the Vanishing Hitchhiker here at this, and I should again talk with this lady, with the student, and get to know more about the Vepsian traditions, which she definitely knows because she comes from the region. But roads are a haunted place in so many cultures. Roads are dangerous. And the legend plots, well, they vary to a certain extent, they take different directions. But the idea or even the experience that you can encounter some dangerous entities on the road is, you find it in very many, very many cultures, often in experienced stories. And my knowledge mainly comes from northeastern India, where this hitchhiking, those entities, they are very common in this story.
I noticed that most of your examples, or at least many of your examples, were narratives conveyed by people of science, sophistication, who might be expected to not believe in these kinds of encounters. Part one of my question is, was that intentional to make the point that this kind of belief is very widespread, not isolated in terms of class or geography or so on? The related question is, given the nature of the evidence, do you think it's important for the folklore scholar to always maintain a stance of non-belief in relation to the evidence that you face? Or is there a point at which the observer said, well, maybe?
Well, the question about this connection between the scientific mindsets, I don't mind at all if it became a point. It was not my intention, because I could have brought different examples from different kind of people, like this, including some clergymen. Of course, they have special relationship with the other world. And then with the students who tell about the experience from the childhood, curious, but it's around maybe 30%. Not everybody witnesses this. It's also a percentage that is given by David Hoffman. Not everybody has this, but some people do. And the second question, should we maintain disbelief? Well, again, what is our role? We fill so many roles in this world. We are not only scientists or scholars, we are also human beings, and we are parents, and we are part of this the folklore process. I think as folklorists, it's always good to have an analytical mindset, to try to apply it as much as possible. But on the other hand, we all carry different kind of modes of thought, including a Brazilian approach and understanding that we also carry magical thinking and poetic, creative thinking. I think it helps. It gives at least some empathy, maybe, to understand what is there, definitely. Not to doubt, though it is. Well, we can doubt in storytelling, in interviews also. We can have a free, open discussion. That's also a way of making sources. But we should not really make fun of the people who are sometimes really encountering something that we don't know. Maybe.
My question is sort of based on Dorian's. How traditional is there a tendency for local beliefs, traditional beliefs, to pop up when encountering these new numinous experiences? And like you, I found that students in introductory folklore classes, like this class in traditional storytelling in Dublin, year after year, 100 people, and their first assignment was to collect items tradition, any kind of story. And I found to my surprise that the natural legends were the largest genre. And again, to my surprise, of those supernatural legends, it wasn't, you know, the urban legends or even straight ghost stories, but, you know, the banshee, you know, where 18-year-olds got up quite emotively in class and said, "What do you mean that's nonsense? I heard the banshee cry." So that was interesting to me that they were actually using the building blocks of traditional narrative and belief rather than at war, as well as subscribing to internationally that kind of thing. What about Estonia?
Yeah, well, I think that the environment, the natural environment, nature, is holy sites, and the ways of the behaving in places is acting out, not only sharing beliefs. It matters even more to be able to create the experience. And as regards, of course, people often, if they know, they don't have traditional beliefs, and they use something that they've heard, maybe from their grandparents or from the primary school lessons or whatever. They have encountered something that's about this fictionalized legendary, and they bring it back to life. It's a kind of resource that you can use. It's a cultural resource. And as regards the legendary and the supernatural stories, I think has some kind of important duties or functions to do. We can talk about the affordance of a genre, what the genre can give you a special kind of perception